Good morning, Gloria Day. This is the day the Lord has made. So we gather and we rejoice in it. It is good to be together. I want to say welcome to you as we gather in this way once again for worship. We are together in the Spirit of God and know that Christ holds us together as one. I want to just take a minute as we begin today to say a big word of thanks to all of the healthcare workers and those that are on the front lines helping to battle this coronavirus for all of us. And so if you're at home with family or if you're watching as an individual today, I just want to stop and give them a round of applause. Can you do that at home? Let's say thank you and clap for all of those healthcare workers and those on the front lines. Let's say a big word of thanks. Thank you so very much to all who are battling this and working so hard for all of us in the community. But again, good to be together as we gather and worship God. Next Sunday is Palm Sunday, and we begin Holy Week a week from today. And so I just want to ask that you pay attention to the emails and posts that come up from Gloria Day, and we'll have a schedule set for you, but we'll let you know well in advance of things that will be posted on Thursday and Friday, and certainly on Easter Sunday as well. But welcome. We're here to gather to worship God, and we're going to move into really a great song called Lord, I Need You. And so just as in the past, so it is today and on into the future that we indeed need God, and we know that Christ is our defense. We know that Christ is indeed our righteousness, and that is the good news and the great news that we proclaim today and every day. So let's sing together, Lord, I Need You.
Without you. We certainly do need God all the time and every day. And so we gather this morning in the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We come to God this morning confessing our sins and trusting in God's mercy and forgiveness for our lives. Please pray with me. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Most merciful God, we confess that we are in bondage to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. And for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. And Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister in the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. We're going to sing together now. As we do, I invite you to join in singing Oceans with us. Thank you.
Hi kids, it's good to be back with you for another make and tell. Parents, I'm gonna remind you to be ready with that pause button for when I ask a question, and we're gonna have one right away. So my first question is, what do you think I'm gonna use today to build something or to make something? Go ahead and ask. So I had one kid make a guess, and he thought that I was gonna make something out of cookies. And we're not using cookies. This is what we're using this week. Oop, they're gonna fall out of my hand even. Got some Legos to work with. So I have another question for you. What do you think I'm going to make out of Legos? So this is what I made today. Can you tell what it is? It's supposed to be a boat. And there are a lot of different Bible stories that have boats in them. But this was one specific story that I was thinking of. This is supposed to be Noah's Ark. Does it look like it? Maybe. So last week I told you I'm not an artist. This week I'll tell you I'm not an engineer either. But I did my best, and it kind of looks kind of neat. I actually put it in some water to see if it would float, and it did for a couple seconds before it sank because there's little spaces, and so it does take on a little bit of water. But so Noah's Ark, who can remember that story? Raise your hand if you remember that story. Cool. Okay, so what are the things you remember? Oh, I've got a good question for you. Do you know how long Noah and his family were in that ark? Ask your grown-ups, see if they know. A lot of people would guess 40 days and 40 nights. And that's part of the story, that there were 40 days and 40 nights, but it was actually 40 days and 40 nights that it was raining. They were inside the ark for way longer than that. So it rained for 40 days and 40 nights. And then there were 150 days where they couldn't see any land. All of the earth was covered with water. It wasn't raining at that point, but there was still water everywhere. And actually, if you want to go look in Genesis chapter 7 and 8, you'll find a lot more details. And big kids and adults, if you would like to do this, you could do a big math problem and try to figure out how many days total it was that they were in the ark. I was looking it up online, and I found it was right around a year, like 364 to 371 days, depending on how they calculated things. That's a long time to be in not a huge space. Do you think we can relate to that at all? Have any of you ever been stuck in one place with your family for a long time? That's what's happening right now, isn't it? Huh. Well, I sure hope that it's not a whole year that we're stuck at home, but we don't know. How do you think Noah got through that whole time being with his family? I'm sure they were kind of getting on each other's nerves after a while, and there are all those animals to take care of, and that was probably really hard. But God was with him through it all and with his whole family. And you know what? God's with you and with your family through everything that we're going through right now as well. So we can rely on him. How about we say a prayer together? Dear God, we thank you that you're with us in this time that we're apart. And this time where we're very together with our family, we thank you for all that you do for us. Amen. Parents, I would love to challenge you again this week. Kids, make something out of Legos. A boat would be really cool if you can make a boat. And then parents, go ahead and send me pictures of your kids through email, and I'll post them on Facebook. It'll be a lot of fun. Thanks, guys.
The gospel today comes from the book of Matthew, starting with chapter 14, verse 22. Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up to the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But by this time, the boat, battered by waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. And early in the morning, Jesus came walking towards them on the sea. But when the disciples saw Jesus walking on the sea, they were terrified, saying, "It's a ghost!" And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them and said, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." Jesus said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat, started walking on the water, and came towards Jesus. But when he noticed the strong winds, he became frightened and began to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and caught him, saying to him, "You of little faith, why did you doubt?" When they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Today we get to join together in this time of message. We are joining in this Matthew time. Again, we're going to talk about Jesus and the disciples out on the boat and talking about Jesus calling them not to be afraid. So as we begin, let us just bow our heads in prayer and let's just quiet our hearts and our minds. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we come together this morning, I just ask that you would be with each and every one of us, everyone that is watching out there in their homes and their places. Heavenly Father, that you would help us to just quiet our hearts and our minds as we are filled up, as we hear your word, as we dig into your word that is spoken to each and every one of us. Help us to put aside the things that have been today that keep us from you, the things that will be our to-do lists, the places that our minds tend to wander. Help us to dig into your scripture. Help us to hear your word to be filled up so that we can be sent. I ask this and everything else in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen. So this text in Matthew 14, is Jesus coming to the disciples walking on water. Not only is he walking on water, but then he calls Peter. He stills the storm and calls Peter out of the boat. This classic, wonderful text, and I have to tell you that this probably ranks on probably my number two of favorite scriptures ever. When I knew a few months ago that I was going to get to preach on this, I was so excited because I just love reminding and remembering God's call to not be afraid and that he is there with us. And I think this weekend, as we don't know what life brings, as we kind of feel like we're in storms of life, we don't know the next thing, this word of God coming is so important. The storm and stilling of the storm and hearing this word of God is there in the midst is just an important one, especially for this weekend. And so as we dig in and as we hear these words, I hope that you feel a sense of God with you. When I was very young, I would say early elementary school, my family used to always go camping. We would go camping all summer long. My dad was in a Bass Pro fishing tournament thing, and so wherever the tournament was is where we would go to go fishing. And it happened to be that this weekend we went up to Mobridge, and my dad, sometimes he'd take us kids out with him, so in the morning at 6 a.m. we'd be out on the water, and my dad would always, he'd get frustrated with us in the boat, and he'd say, next weekend I'm not bringing you with me. And of course, next weekend we were there in the boat with him, and that's just how it always went. But for some reason, this weekend we stayed back at the campsite, and my dad and one of his best friends went out in the boat. Well, all of a sudden, we went into town shopping into Mobridge. There was an Elko, if any of you remember Elkos. So we were in Elko shopping, and we came out of Elko, and there were just these clouds coming up over by the river, and the wind was just picked up like none other. And I remember my mom and her friends saying to us, oh, I bet the guys are off the river because it's looking like it's getting really bad and a storm's coming up. So when you get back to the campsite, I'm sure the guys will be back with the boat and everything. We got back to the campsite and there was no dad to be found. And as things came up and the weather started to get worse and the Game Fish and Parks guy came by, and I remember it so distinctly, him saying, you guys need to pack up and get ready because there's a big storm coming and it's just building and building. And we had to put our pop-up camper back in, and we drove in the truck to go sit where they launched the boats. And when we pulled in, I remember seeing the only trailer that was there without a boat on it was my dad's friend's, because they'd taken my dad's friend's boat out. And so all the other boats had gotten off the river except for my dad and his friend. And the Game Fish and Parks guy came around and he said, we don't know where they're at, but we're checking. We're checking on them. And so we sat in that parking lot, and as the storm hit and came and came and came, and I remember wondering how my dad was and where he was at and what was happening. And finally, the Game Fish and Parks guy pulls in, and he has my dad and his friend, and they had their life jackets on, and they looked like they had been through quite the ordeal. Their boat was taking on water, and my dad knew how to swim, but his friend didn't, and all these fears and anxieties went through them. And to this day, we still joke that my dad will only take the boat out if there's not a cloud in the sky. That changed who he was. And in today, in the text, we hear these words. We hear in the text that Jesus is praying by himself, and it is evening. When evening came, Jesus was there all alone. By this time, the boat, battered by waves, was far from the land, for the wind was against them. It's evening, and all of a sudden, things switch like this. Life changes. Those disciples, they're in the middle of the storm, and my dad, that storm that he was in that changed him was only for a few hours, but we hear that these disciples were in the boat all night long. When evening came and Jesus was alone, the disciples were out in the boat. And early in the morning, Jesus came walking towards them on the sea. So all night long, they were in the middle of this storm. And I just want to take a second and talk about the storm for a second, because I think it's important to understand the storm, because you got to know the storm in order to understand the significance of Jesus needing to show up. You have to understand the storm to understand what it meant for them and for us, for Jesus entering in and being there and stilling it. You got to understand the storm to know how bad it really was, to understand the cure and Jesus showing up mattered. I want to think about storms for a second. Now, my dad and these disciples were an actual physical storm that happened around them in a boat, but we all know that we have storms in our lives. We have places when things seem and feel like they are out of control. And a lot of times it happens pretty quick in our lives. I can think of this time period as we sit at home and as we watch TV and as we hear updates and as we don't know, maybe some of you have lost jobs and are unsure of financial problems. Maybe some of you are at home self-isolating because you yourself are afraid that you are going to get sick and have been told that you can't or that that's not a good idea. Or maybe some of us are at home with our kids trying to figure out what it means to homeschool. Maybe some of you are teachers that are trying to figure out a new way after so many years of teaching how to love and care for our families from a distance and make sure that our kids get a good education. Maybe it's some of you that are showing up to work every day in the medical field and trying to figure out what that means, how to keep yourself safe, your family safe, and being on the front lines. Maybe it's some of you that are state and government workers trying to figure out what that means and how we can care for one another. Some of you have showed up at the banquet. Some of you have showed up at Feeding South Dakota. Wherever you're at, we all feel the storm that is around us. That feels like we are not in control. We feel the storm of not understanding exactly what's ahead of us, knowing that we have a part in being able to slow the curve, but still feeling like we're not sure. And in the midst of the storm, God enters in, Jesus enters in, and he calms the storm and he says, "Do not be afraid." I remember the moment I've shared with many of you before about when my husband fell and broke his back. It was February, I believe, 5 years ago when Eric broke his back. And I remember he broke his back on a Friday, 10 o'clock is what time I got that call, just like you and I, like any of those storms in our lives. I share this because you can think of all those places and things that have happened in your life. 10 o'clock on Friday, Saturday he was in surgery all day, and then Sunday I started to kind of go through the repercussions financially of what that meant, how that was going to work. We had three young, very young children at home. How was I going to be a mom to them? How was I going to be a pastor? How was I going to be a wife? All of those things. And I remember starting to just get very nervous standing there in the hospital, wondering how is this all going to work out? And I just remember thinking to myself, I had nothing left of myself to give. I had nothing left of myself to even know except for the next spot that I could go, my next step. I didn't know what the week looked like. I didn't know what the month looked like, but I knew that I could do the next 5 minutes or the next 10 minutes or whatever that meant. And I just really had to lean in to God. because I couldn't plan all of the things because I didn't know what they would be. So it forced me to not rely on myself, but to rely fully and completely on God. And I remember this really wise pastor, he's a runner and a hiker, and he said when you go on hiking, that you always know the next marker. So you go around a spot and you don't know the whole route and you don't know exactly where you're gonna go, but you know the next spot. And so you look for the next flag and then you look for the next flag. And he said, Sarah, you just gotta look for the next thing because that's how God is guiding you through this time right now and this time of uncertainty. And so I did that. And I just went forward to the next step of the next thing that I could accomplish today or the next day. And you know what? I look back on those days and I can't account for the time. I can't account for the money. I can't account for my own mental health. I can't account for how the house got cleaned or anything. Because I really feel like in that time when I had to fully rely on God, that I couldn't be afraid that God had this, was actually when my strength and my faith were at its best. I think in these days of uncertainty, we don't know all the time what tomorrow brings. Sometimes we just know what I can do in this hour or this next minute, or how I can love my children, how I can make a phone call, how I can, whatever I can do, that God has the rest and that I get to live in the midst of that knowing that God is God and I am not. The do not be afraid. We hear these words that the disciples were not in the midst of the storm alone, and neither are we. God enters in, and that doesn't mean that everything is perfect. It doesn't mean that everything is grand. It doesn't mean that everything goes exactly how we planned, but it means that God is there. And that is a promise that goes beyond. And then we have Peter, right? I always say I'm a lot like Peter. If you're going to ask me which disciple I'm like, it would be a Peter. And so we have Peter, who says, you know, he's kind of sometimes doubts or wonders what's going on. And he said, Lord, if it is you, command me to come out of the water. Come to you on this water. And Jesus says, come. So Peter gets out of the boat and starts walking on water towards Jesus. But then Peter starts to doubt that. So we have these moments of greatness and these moments of remembering that it is okay and that we are okay. And then we doubt and we wonder and then we sink. And then Jesus reaches down and pulls Peter up. Even in Peter's doubt, even in his wonder, even in his being afraid, even in whatever it is, Jesus is still there and the promise is still there for us. And then we start over again and we pray and we remember who God is and we lean in again. That's why this thing of prayer and coming to God and coming together, even if it's virtually, is so important. To remind each other over and over and over who it is that is in control. Who it is that created the heavens and the earth. Who is the beginning and the end. Who we truly worship and who went to the cross for our sins and saved us and gives us new life in this world and in the next. It is Jesus Christ. And so today as we come and we know that this is what I can do next, we can sing songs, we can worship, we can pray together, we can be community from a distance, and we can proclaim the name of Jesus Christ. To not be afraid, because God is with you. God is with you wherever you are. God is with you in your homes, in your families. God is with you in your struggles, in your joys, and your concerns, and your weakness, and your wonders, wherever it is, God walks with you. And we just ask that he would give you strength, that you would know the strength and the peace that passes all understanding, the strength and the peace that only comes from from him. As we lean into the promise, as we hear the words of forgiveness for each and every one of us, you are a child of God, now and forever, no matter what, end of story. And so as we walk these Lenten days, I hope that you remember whose you are. I want you to think about ways and places that maybe you are struggling and places and things that you worry about and leave those at the foot of the cross. That those are God's. Those are God's worries. That's the place that we leave those things. And that you take on new life and you take on strength and you take on peace and you take on this mind of knowing that God has this and that is enough for today. So my peace and my blessings, I hope God leaves with you. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just give you thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ. We give you thanks that we remember the promise that he came to this earth that we might have life. He took on our brokenness, the brokenness of this world, sin and pain and whatever it is that we deal with and gives us new life. Lord, help us to lay those at the foot of the cross. Lord, help us to know that we are yours now and forever. And in our everyday way and space, Lord, help us to shine that light into our world. Help us to pass on and to be church together. We ask this in your name, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us join together and confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. We will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. And please join with us as we pray. Kind and loving Lord, we've come before you to once again celebrate the life you have gifted us with. We are grateful for your constant and loving presence in our life and how you reveal yourself to us day by day. Help us to be open to your authority and mighty power so that we might be filled with your health, wholeness, and new life. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your love for us that is complete and perfect and unconditional. And inspire us and instill in us faith and obedience to share with one another in the world your great love and tender mercies so that all might come to know your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we come to you this day and we give you thanks for our teachers, for our administrators, for our parents, for our students, Lord. First of all, we just ask that you would keep them healthy, that you would care for them and keep them whole, give them strength. Lord, we give you thanks that they have worked tirelessly to make learning from a distance work. Lord, we give you thanks for the amazing work that we are doing as community, being community together. We give you thanks for the hours that are put in to make sure that we care for our families and for our kids. We just ask that as we go about the next few weeks, that you would give us all patience and grace with one another and with ourselves. Lord, we know that you are there in the midst as we work to care for our children and as we work to care for a distance for the students that our teachers have. Lord, we just ask that you would be with our church school leaders for those that cannot be in this place to help our kids raise them in the faith. Lord, we just ask that you be with our families as they continue to care for their kids to pass on the faith. To help them know that they are loved and that God is there with them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
God, we trust in your goodness and in your healing. give you thanks for the work that you do in and through our doctors and our nurses and our care teams, those who work in healthcare. We ask that you would continue that work, Lord. We pray that you would keep our healthcare workers safe, that you would watch over them. If they get sick, help them to get well. Lord, we ask for your guidance for those who are in medical research. We pray for your wisdom that they might know exactly what to do when they need to do it, and help us all to know how to keep one another safe. Lord, we also come today trusting in your healing for those who are sick. For those who are sick for any reason, whether it be cancer or a cold or the flu or for coronavirus, Lord, we ask for your healing. We trust in you. Lord, surround us all in health. Give us your grace. You are the great physician, and we come to you today knowing that we can put our faith and trust in the work you are doing through the many hands that are working in these industries. We ask for your grace and your love and your healing. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
And gracious God, we know that your Son Jesus, our Savior and our Lord, is Lord of the church. You provide us with so many good gifts. We give you thanks today for the gift of your church, for creating us into a family, making us to be a family together. You've created us to be in community with one another. So today, let's lift up churches around our city, around our nation, around the world that are gathering today, many like we are through social media. But just ask your blessing on all that are gathered in your name. We give you thanks for your church, and we ask you to bless its leaders, to bless all of its members. We know that indeed, God, through your Holy Spirit, that your church is the hope for this world. And so as we continue together as a congregation and as a worldwide church to proclaim the good news that you are Lord of all, we do give you thanks that you walk with us through every aspect of our life, but certainly are walking with us through this journey that we're on now. And so God, as we're gathered together with families, with friends, via social media and congregations, we just lift up and say thank you for what you provide for us and the way in which we can be together and proclaim and minister to one another. We pray all these things in the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now may God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit order your days and your deeds according to his gracious will. In Jesus' name, amen. And now let's praise God by singing together, My Feet Are on the Rock.
Thank you. safety, so stop the beat. Clap your hands up, Peter. I cannot be my hope of time to break. I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. When I feel my hope of time to break, I will cling to your unchanging grace. Let the waters come and the earth give way. I'll be dancing in the rain. I'm Peter on the rock.
Thank you for worshiping with us online here at Gloria Day, and I want to say thank you for keeping this congregation and churches everywhere in your prayers during these days. And as we keep our ministry strong and vibrant, your prayers are appreciated, but also as you are able, please keep your offerings and tithes up as well, as much as you can. Just a reminder that you can mail in a check to Gloria Day or drop it off, or you can actually go online onto our website or onto our app, and you can give online as well. Thank you. And let's go in peace and serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.